I'm joined here today by Mr. Praful Zaveri, the man who has written some amazing chess books. Mr. Zaveri, what are you going to show us today? And one of your works which has received great appreciation from the entire chess community.
Basically, like I would start with the chess course, which I had penned in the year 1999. And I think that was for me really satisfying work. The idea for this book came like when we were teaching, and then we used to give notes to the students, and ultimately like these notes accumulated, and then the idea of the book came. And so in 1998 I started putting all these notes in order, and we were able to bring it out, the first edition, in the year 1999.
So what we have here, the entire series of seven books, is it?
Yeah.
Seven books is not a work of 1 year. Yeah, it's two decades.
Definitely. Yeah, it's a work of two decades. So like, as I said, 1999, the first edition of the chess course came. And then later on, while teaching at my academy, the Indian Chess School, we thought that this was not sufficient, and children needed more positions to study, or more chapters to study. And then came the idea of workbooks in the year 2012. I started writing these books in 2012, and the first four book came in the year 2013. So that was like a series of workbooks. So we teach from the chess course, which is a parent book, and then students solve the corresponding chapter in the workbook.
Fantastic. Can we have a look at it? Yeah. And know what it is. Yeah. About. So this entire thing that you have designed is a cover, yeah?
This cover has been designed by my friend and a very passionate chess player by name Mr. Aman Shah. Mm-hmm. He runs a designing academy, and in fact designs a cover page of all the six workbooks have been designed by him, and also the logo of Indian Chess School also.
So you have this as the parent book, the chess course.
This is the parent book, and as I said, like it's a basically a primer. So even anyone who is a layman to chess will be able to understand and learn chess from by going through this book. So we start with a very basic, what is a game of chess, and the interesting story about the origin history of the game. Mm-hmm. And why chess, and then it goes on to the chessboard, chessman, and accordingly we cover like all the basic part. And like you solve something from here, say for example chessboard. Okay. Then you have a corresponding chapter in the workbook. So like this is the workbook one, and here we have the chapter. And so like these are the sample question given. So is the chessboard placed correctly? And if the students feel yes, it is correct, and then we'll be putting tick here. Here you will see that it's not correct because the black square is on the right hand corner, and accordingly we'll put no. And like in this question, here it says white says two chessmen are not arranged correctly, circle it. And then you will see that I've not put the rook and knight in the correct position, and you will circle it. So
basically you learn from this book the basics.
Yeah.
And then you go and do the solving from here.
Correct. So these are the corresponding workbook. So you'll be solving here. And so like here you start with a very fundamental question, number all the squares on the chessboard. So even though like we tell as a trainer, okay, there are 64 squares on the chessboard, but when students write down all these numbers on the square, it becomes very easy, and the foundation becomes very strong.
And there is something that I see here, a box next to everything which has marks on it.
Yeah. So like it is, say even if a trainer is teaching in a group, it becomes very easy for him to evaluate and assess each of the student individually. So after finding out, he will be checking the book, and then he'll be putting whether the student has been able to solve it correctly. He'll be awarding the mark as per the scoring pattern which has been given at the end of the chapter and end of the book. So like for example, chessboard and chessman has 34 questions. There is one mark for each of the correct position solved. So total is maximum is 34, and he will write down the student's score here, and then he will give the percentage. So if anything more than 75, it will be marked as excellent. So I feel that like when a student completes all these 34 positions and final marks, and then you get to know the how much students has imbibed.
So according to you, if someone goes through, let's say, the first book, the first workbook, he would learn how to play chess.
Correct.
and they have to read the chess course and then solve it from there.
Yeah.
And is it only for if they have a trainer or they can do it on their own as well?
I feel trainer is needed. Okay, especially when you say do the beginning part, say even like a parent only knows the elementary basics of chess, he can very easily help help his child in solving the basic part of the game. But like when the level goes on increasing, the trainer role becomes important. So I feel that trainer is must. And this book basically supplements the trainer. It becomes easy because like you have a set curriculum in front of you, know what to teach and what to expect from the student. And for student, it also becomes easy that whatever he has learned, that books are for him. And for him, it's also easy for parents to judge that how his or her child is doing.
So after the first book, they know how to play, and then what happens next in the second book?
Then we go to the second level, which is basically like we start learning checkmates. So the first step in this, it's a big book, 230 pages devoted only for level 2. And here the chapters covered are, we start with elementary checkmate with two rooks. So this I have devised in a unique way, like we teach them how to deliver elementary checkmate with two rooks, the pattern, the plan involved in this. We show them the final checkmating position. This is how you push the king into the corner rank or a corner file, and then one of the rook prevents the escape and other rook delivers the checkmate. And then, you know, to find out whether the students have done correctly, we set up this position, the basic elementary position on the board. And here the students are required to play with white. And I, as a trainer, used to play with black simultaneously on the board. So, you know, like then it helps me to find out whether all my students, whether they have understood to learn to deliver checkmate with two rooks. And in some cases, I even used to make illegal moves just to find out, you know, whether the student is able to spot these illegal moves. So this is something unique idea where, you know, the testing method is given. So how to solve it is, it says practical demonstration against the trainer. So these are some of ideas which basically I've got from my own teaching methods to put it in this way.
So here you see that there is a score sheet below here, which is given. So the students have to write their moves over here.
So like when I come on the board, the student will play their move. Say like, for example, he plays R to H4 and I move my king to D5. So he'll be writing down both the moves. And again, when I come to the same board, he'll be carrying forward from here. So like they also will be learning in a proper way how to play simultaneously, not to make the moves when the principal player is away from the board.
But don't you think writing the notation itself is a problem for the students? How do they learn it? Is it?
I feel that this part has been neglected by most of the trainers who are teaching the basic elementary fundamentals of chess. So that's why what I've done, I've taken care in the first book to devote nothing less than 9 chapters for notations only. So we have broken down into various elements. Say like, for example, here the chapter 8 shows algebraic chess notations. So here I'll be just trying to make them understand what are notations. They learn this from the parent book. And so like if you come here, then the question says, draw the line showing 8 files on the chessboard. Now they will come to know that files are verticals line. So they'll be drawing this 8 verticals line. This makes them very easy to understand that these are called files. And then accordingly draw 8 ranks. So they'll be putting in the horizontal line. And then we ask them write file names. So they understand, okay, these are now the file names. So they'll be writing everywhere A here, B. So like, you know, after breaking down into this element, it becomes very easy for student to master the fundamentals of notations, which are must for any player. And then accordingly, they will go further, name all the white squares. So they'll just be now writing down the white square name. So A2, A4, A6, A8, and so on, all the black square. Then they'll be identifying what squares are here. So they'll be writing down, this is A4, B6, C8, E7, and that way. And then you write name of all the 64 squares.
Okay. So in this sense, they learn the notation very well before moving to the next book.
Next level, yeah.
Fantastic. So first book is with the basics. Second book is with mating patterns, and they learn. What about the third book?
Yeah. Now, basically, when we come to the third book, we want children to go into what we say, the fun part of the middle game, mm-hmm. so where the tactics come in. But before the tactics, again, I have laid emphasis to elementary checkmates. So like in the book 2, we had elementary checkmate with 2 rooks and elementary checkmate with queen. So now here they go further and then solve elementary checkmate with 1 rook and elementary checkmate with double bishops.
Mm, okay.
Yeah, so this again, they have to solve in the same method as in previous. They have to give practical demonstration against the trainer to find out whether they are able to deliver checkmate with 1 rook and simultaneously also with 2 bishops.
2 bishops is not easy.
Yeah, 2 bishops is not easy, but like, you know, when we tell them that, okay, you have to just remember to move the bishop in a zigzag way, and in the central files, you will be able to cover most of the square. Basically, you're like, you'll be building a diagonal walls. So like this, I have shown in the main chess course, the ideas through arrows. And of course, when we teach at our academy, we use chess base, so it becomes more easy to show with arrows.
There it is.
So like you take the first marker is like, say, when the push bishop on d3 and bishop on e3 and king on e2, then you know you have built a diagonal wall. So now this wall is has a lot of means, the opponent king has a lot of squares to move in, but like when he goes further and make progress, the wall becomes smaller. This is what we see here. And then ultimately we ask them to reach the stop position is that we put the king in one of the corner and just take care here that the stalemate does not arise. And again, this is another important marker which I teach them, that you should put your own king at a knight square distance to the enemy king. So like when they reach this position, the idea becomes very easy to deliver checkmate.
Fantastic. So in book 3, after learning checkmating with the rook and 2 bishops, they then move on to pin.
Yeah, so here I've covered 8 tactics. We start with pin. So these are there in the principal book. So from this point onwards, solving in the principal book and workbook goes on simultaneously. So you solve part one, basically, like I can show you here.
But they are different positions.
They are definitely different positions and more interesting. So like, you know, they'll be getting a lot of positions to solve. So for example, now we start with a very basic pinning. So all the explanation are done here. And like we even have some good games to study it. Like we say, this is the famous John Nunn game where the pinning came from a very long range in a Caro-Kann defense, a very famous trap he had set. So then when they learned what is a pin, the types of pin, and how to even do unpinning, then they start solving from this. So basically they have to solve part one and not to go to part two, because they are still at the infantry stage of their learning, the elementary stage. So you're like, say, in this position, so they will play, okay, I can find out a pin by playing R2, A8, and the bishop here on D8 is pinned. Black only has king to F8, H8 is blunder because it allows mate in one. So like then this type of position makes them understand the pinning. Mm-hmm. And then they continue from here, and then they go to this workbook where they have 20 positions to solve. So like, again, this is a very simple position. So bishop is pinning the g7 pawn, and the idea is to play queen into h6 check and mate. Or like if you take this position, queen is on f6 and black king on f8, and rook f3 pins the queen and leads to an elementary win. So like when they solve this 2 movers, 3 movers, it becomes more easy to understand the ideas, and they can put it effectively into use when they play the practical tournament games.
Right. So until now they have learned how to mate, and they also learned the basic tactics. So how do they improve further from book 4 now?
Yeah, now when we move on to book 4 comes the most interesting stage, the endgame stage, which normally most of us ignore. Like
but many people say you should teach the endgame in book 2 or book 1, maybe book 2.
Yeah.
Why book 4?
I feel, you know, like endgame, though, I mean, it has to be taught early. The elementary part, but I still feel that, you know, students are more fascinated by the middle game, where, you know, they try to learn combinations and tactics, which is the fun part. And, you know, like this gives them more pleasure and kindles more, what we say, joy of chess. I also feel that, okay, endgame has to come early, but I feel that here I put it in book 4 because, you know, let them, it's a little more complex, even though positions are very basic, it is more complex. So that is the reason why I put it, delayed it further.
Okay. And how do they approach the endgame?
Endgame, yeah. So I here started with the book covers, 12 chapters, which are absolutely necessary for any player to know. So for like, we start with what is opposition. So then the opposition has been taught to them from the main book. So like here we teach them three types of opposition, when kings are standing on the same color and separated by an odd number. And so here both kings are separated by one square and standing on each color. So this is the, we tell them this is vertical opposition, this is horizontal opposition, and this is a diagonal opposition. And then they go on to solve this book. And so here it asks them, what is the type of opposition? So here they'll be marking, this is vertical, this is horizontal, and this is diagonal. And then we teach them the importance of opposition, that how means gaining an opposition is an advantage. Of course, it doesn't mean that wins the game, but it allows you to control more number of squares. So like ultimately when a pawn comes into picture, it helps you, you know, to navigate your king in a better way. So then we say like black to play, which side loses opposition. So we tell them that in endgame everything is opposite. Like sometimes having a move is a disadvantage. So like here it is black to play. Black is having the move and he has to move. So he'll be ceding one of the important square here. So like if he moves to c5, he'll be losing the control of the a5 square. Or if he moves to a6, he'll be losing the control, ceding c5 square. And then a very famous position, this is my personal best, and it says white to play and reach a8. Or c8 in 17 moves maximum. So it's basically like, you know, here there is nothing to win, only two kings are left on the board, but like it helps them to learn. Means I think no position teaches opposition better than this one. So like it's a distant opposition, that white plays king to h2 and gains distant opposition, and then later on the distant opposition becomes direct opposition, say when they are near to the square. And by triangulation, black is able to, white is able to reach one of the squares.
It's very natural to play king g2 because you want to run towards.
You want to run fast. Yes. And this was what most of the students do. So they try to play g2, and then they find that, you know, black king goes to g8, and in no case you can reach a8 or c8.
So how do the people use, like for example, let's say they play king g2, do you make them write in pencil here so that rub it off again?
So like this instruction has been given in all the books at the start itself, that how to go through this book. So here it says that you have to write down all the answers in pencil, because like the basic idea is to even revise the book, and not only revise the book, even if you have solved it incorrectly, it becomes very easy to erase that part and write it again.
Okay. So the endgame part is covered well here. They learn the pawn endgame. They also, do they learn the Philidor and
yes.
All the rook endgames.
Yeah. Even pawn endings, I have done it in a different way. So like first I have taught them what are the positions encounter in a king and pawn ending. So basically these are the four positions which teach them, that this is king behind the pawn, this is king one square in front of the pawn, king two square in front of the pawn, and king on the sixth rank in front of the pawn, and the rules governing this position. So for example, we say that when king is behind the pawn, it's always a draw. Only thing is, means the defending side needs to play proper moves, gain opposition at the right time, create a blockade and stop the progress of the pawn. So you know, like it becomes very easy. Now when they understand this, all these four rules, so for example, we ask them, what is the rule for king behind the pawn? So then they write here, always a draw. Then they understand that king behind the pawn is always a draw. But now, then the next interesting part is where they have to demonstrate this practically. They have learned this. So this says now, demonstrate how white can draw from this position. Black has a pawn advantage and the pawn is rushing down towards promotion on d1. So natural would be white attacks the pawn, places king to d3. black comes here, defends the pawn by playing his king to c5. And now here, white knows the rule that I should, you know, go back to d2 and not to c2. Because if I go to c2, it will allow black king to play to c4 and take a position. So he knows that I should move back straight. And only when black plays his king to c4, I will take a position with c2.
Mm-hmm.
And when black plays, pushes his pawn to d3 and gives a check, and then I will create a blockade by moving my king to d2. So this is the practical part, and this to be solved in the same way that like the trainer will be playing simultaneously here on the board, and then he'll be guiding the students if at all they play a wrong move. So like all the four positions are covered in depth here, and when they solve this 10 positions, the last one is very interesting because it uses a triangulation method here. So then they become very good in understanding the concepts of the endgame.
Okay, and then moving on to the fifth book, what's next?
Yeah, so in book three, we had covered a lot of tactics, and book three is continuation of that whatever tactics were left out, we do it in book five. But book five, we come to last of the elementary checkmate with bishop and knight, which is of course very difficult. Like say when I was writing this book in revising this book in year 2007, and then I went through a database, then I was able to find out that there were nearly 1015 games with bishop and knight ending, and all involving good players, something around 2500, most of them GM caliber. And then I found out that at least 15 games the GM was not able to win. Of course, we do not know, he might be in time trouble, but then one thing was very clear, that of course it is the most difficult part of the elementary mate. Very, even the good players, they means like fail at a vital moment, and the game ends in a draw by 50 move rule. So book five starts with elementary checkmate with bishop and knight, but not the practical part. Here something unique is given, that 10 positions are given, and they are all, you have to find checkmate. So like this position, you have to find checkmate in one move. So of course this very element is easy, you'll be able to find bishop to c3 and checkmate. And then we go further, white to play in checkmate in two moves. So again, it'll be knight f1 and bishop f3, and then mate in 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And then like I feel that when you reach 10 moves, are able to calculate 10 moves without moving the pieces, or like I feel that by the time the student must have matured enough. So then I think this will be a big improvement in becoming a very strong player. So this is one idea, and the practical part of this is covered in book 6, so that final they will be able to demonstrate checkmate with bishop and knight.
And so the theory part is in the chess course, and then they solve in the book 5.
Yeah. But like as I said, that from book 3 or book 2 onwards, both of these books go parallel. So you have to also solve it in the chess course as well in the workbook.
Okay. And what's next after bishop, knight, this book 5, you said there are some advanced tactics.
So like then we cover the remaining tactics. Then one chapter I have is checkmating patterns. So okay, they have all come by what we say by tradition. Say for example, let us take this position. So like we have various mates which have come down to tradition. So Anastasia mate or Anderson's mate. So like take Anderson's mate on rook on h8 and supported by the bishop on b2, or Arabian mate, a mate with bishop and knight. These are the only two pieces which have not undergone change of any movement. Like all other pieces, their rules have changed. So like a queen did not have that much power, or bishop did not have power. But right from say the origin of chess in India, from the earlier time, say the olden days chaturangam, to the modern day chess, only bishop and knight movements have not been changed. And like as game has evolved, the origin was India, and then it went to Persia, and then to the Arab world, where you know they means played a real part in developing the game in that period. So the mate with rook on the 7th rank and supported by a knight on f6, say, or c6, it's known as Arabian mate. So these are various names given. We have Apollate mate, Juridon mate, where the rooks are on both the sides, or Greekosis mate, Morphosis mate, or Smothered mate. So they have to solve these 50 positions, and they have to write down what type of checkmating pattern they are getting. So
okay, the name of the
name
pattern.
Of the pattern.
Wow.
So like we teach them this. I'd written an article on this in 2007 after I passed the trainer's examination at Singapore. and it was published in the Singapore chess journal they used to take out at the Asian Academy. So my teacher, I am Joan Petroni, also the FIDE senior trainer, and the one who has inspired me to do all these things. So he liked that article very much, and of course he was also the inspiration for me to write further books. So this part of course has not been included in the main chess course, and like when I revise this book further, I'd be putting up this chapter which is badly missing for a long time.
And I see that there's one quote written at the back of the book. What is it?
Yeah, so like what I've done in each and every book, I've tried to put in a quote. So like when Chess Course was written in 1999, this is the quote, a very famous quote of Alexander Kuprin, which I put. It says, how splendid to be king, ruling not by right of succession or by chance plebiscite, but power of one's own mind. So, you know, it emphasizes the importance of the king and the game of chess. Mm-hmm. So for every book, I have found out quotes which are, you know, very unique and rarely used. So like this, the famous quote by Benjamin Franklin, the US president, who has written one of the most interesting, guide to chess, the morals of chess. And this is from Morals of Chess, and it says, by playing at chess, we may learn first foresight, which looks a little into futurity. Second, circumspection, which surveys the whole chessboard. Third, caution, not to make our moves too hastily.
Nice.
So some unique quotes I have taken. And like when we take book two, I put a quote of Donald MacLean, shows the love for chess. Take these pieces, set them in the rank and file upon an 8x8 magic square, and you have the recipe for endless centuries of romance and intrigue. So like it was a, you know, a lot of fun in finding out some of this rare, and this is one by famous painter John Goethe, and says daring ideas are like chessmen moved forward, they may be beaten, they may start a winning game.
Nice.
And in four we have the famous Lewis Carroll quote, Through the Looking Glass, the sequel to the book. And it says, it's a great huge game of chess that's being played all over the world. If this is the world at all, you know, oh, what fun it is. How I wish I was one of them. I wouldn't mind being a pawn if only I'd my joint. Though, of course, I should like to be a queen best. And then in book five, it teaches, it shows something of an undiscovered element, maybe a god. So this is the famous Huxley quote. It says, the chessboard is the world. The pieces are the phenomena of the universe. The rules of the game are what we call the laws of nature. The player on the other side is hidden from us. So maybe the player on the other side maybe refers to as something as God.
Mm-hmm.
And finally, to book one, and of course this is my favorite, because like the sixth book, the quote from this book was basically like a lot of researchers, basically they were from England. So like we take the name of Duncan Forbes. So he was the one who had written a very beautiful book, The History of Chess. That was an 1860 publication, and it's a very big book, and basically it traces the origin of the game right from the old Chaturanga time to the modern game, and it spread throughout Europe. And there he has a famous quote which is given in the Mahabharata, which he has quoted from Bhavishya Purana, and where Yudhishthira asks Vyas, tell me, O my master, how the Chaturji, which is basically referred to as checkmate, may be accomplished. And then Yudhishthira, the Vedmuni Vyas, gives him an account regarding the whole, the pattern, puts the movement of the pieces. But this is the last part. He says, how to avoid checkmate? He says, let each player preserve his own forces with excessive care, and remember that the king is most important of all. O prince, from inattention to the humbler pieces, the king may fall into disaster. So this is how, you know, like it's it also sums up that this game owes its existence to India, and a country which means where people are endowed with superior powers, that they have evolved this game. Or
you took us in this fantastic journey of quotes. So we were at book number six. We were looking at book five had all the advanced tactics, as you said, and now book six has something interesting, very unique that you have created.
So like as I said, book one, two, three and four were written in the year 2013. It started in 2012 and culminated in 2013. And then later on, while teaching at the school, we found that these four also were not enough, and that gave rise to book 5 and later on to book 6. But book 6, I was myself not sure, maybe, you know, did not have that much level of expertise to understand that, like, what needs to be done to push a player who is something in the vicinity of 1800 to 2000 or 2100. But then I said, okay, let us, you know, go by how the great masters have gone. And so this idea came. So we started with...
You are saying that this book is also for players about 2000.
I feel, yes. Like, once I feel that if you go systematically into the 5 books and also solve this book, where, you know, you will have tougher positions when you go at the later stage of the game, then this should easily push you something in the range of up to 1800 ELO. And from here on, you can try to push it to cross 2000 barrier if you solve this book, which I feel should require nothing less than a year or a year and a half.
Okay. So coming to this 6th book.
So here what I've done, this is the advanced part 3, the last of this series. And herein I have put in this chapter. So traps and pitfalls in the opening offer, these are all very basic. But then it from this 50 position, some of them are really tough and gives a player a fair idea, means what are the traps and pitfalls he encounters in a game of chess. And then we come into chess compositions and problems. This, of course, very interesting. It is said that, okay, like most of the players said, it has nothing to do with practical chess, and some of the over-the-board players, they are not comfortable with solving this. But I feel, you know, it has a lot of aesthetic value, and it shows how rich the chess is, and it's also fun to solve this. It's like a real joy to solve this.
So how many studies or compositions are there?
So here I have started with checkmate in 2 positions. And so, like, we take this position and it's checkmate in 2, and here, say, like, we have position white plays is queen to d6.
We had to ask our viewers to solve it. Okay, queen d6. Okay.
So, like, if here needs to be solved, then maybe basically should take this position.
Okay.
And this was given to Stenitz. It's a very good anecdote about it. And Stenitz used to solve these positions, like, you know, it's just a matter of walk for him. And when this position was given to him, he couldn't find the solution for a long time, almost I think 30 minutes. And, you know, then he came to the question that whether the position was set correctly or not. And then later on, we found out that, okay, it was his own failing. The position was correct, but he was not able to solve it. Mm-hmm. So, you know, he rates this position highly. I think this is to be solved.
So we will ask our viewers to pause the video, or you can, after this video is completed, to solve this one. It's white to play and checkmate in 2 moves. Try it out. If you can solve it within 30 minutes, then you do better than Stenitz. Okay. So it has 50 studies in this section.
So we have 25 checkmating positions. So these are all goes further. White to play, checkmate in 2. We go further from here. White to play, checkmate in 3. Now, this is one of my personal favorite, though it is, you know, like a very basic position, an elementary 2-move checkmate. But what is important, you know, this was composed by the great Pomer, Arthur Pomer, when he was only 9 years old. Wow. So this is something amazing, and, you know, like...
So it's mate in 3.
It's mate in
3. Another homework for our viewers.
Yes, yeah.
This video is becoming heavy. Okay.
And of course, this one is also fantastic. Mm-hmm. It's a famous Dawson's composition. Like, you have to reach this position. It's basically a knight tour, and where the black also cooperates. He has to capture all of 15 of the black six chessmen and come back to the original position. And from this position, then the king reaches h4, and here white has to mate in 3.
So this is mate in 3
mate
for white.
Yes.
Okay.
And then it goes further, checkmate in 3, and then in 4, and then in 6. Of course, this is a very famous composition whereby a knight delivers a checkmate. And finally, we culminate this 25 position. Like the last one is white to play and checkmate in 12. So here we use the pattern of zigzag or the staircase pattern, whereby the queen moves and delivers checkmate when the king is on b1. And then we come to the task where it is not a checkmate, but to find a win. And started with the very famous Saavedra position. I think this is the first position the kid should know. You know, he'll fall in love with the game. When I was a kid and I was given this position, you know, and we could not solve it for n number of days. Of course, at that time there was no training or this, but I tempted myself from looking at the solution. And when finally, after, you know, so many days, I could not solve it, and then I looked through the solution and found the answer amazing, you know, and like increased the love for the game of chess.
So this one is white to play and win.
White to play, yeah. So like one of the famous position composed by Reverend Father Saavedra and came to be known as Saavedra's position. So idea is black uses a very famous trick to stalemate the opponent's king. So this is one they can try to solve. And of course, there's also...
This one I was very surprised when I saw, because black is taking the rook rear and also there are queen coming down to a1 to check. So it's white to play and win in... White to play and win.
It doesn't seem
possible. So we'll ask...
So basically, okay, maybe I think this is...
Yeah, we are going to ask our viewers to pause this and try to think over it. But then you can show the answer. So if you want to... listen to the answer, you can go ahead, but if you want to solve it, just pause it here.
Okay, so basically this teaches the skewer tactic, and idea here is that, you know, queen a1 check is threatened and also black threatens king into f4. So idea is to play rook a4 and prevent both of these. Now for example, simple queen into a4 allows rook h3 check and king moves anywhere on the fourth rank, and then rook h4 check and we get the queen. Now there is only one defense. Of course, when you play ra r2 a4, queen has c8, that's also, you know,
keeps to stop again rook h3.
To stop rook h3 and also at the same time threatens queen c1 checkmate. So it is again like two threats coming simultaneously. But again here also white uses the same idea. He now plays continues with the same idea, rook h3 check, queen into h3, and again you have rook a3 check and
fantastic
this idea.
Great.
So this is our
so it's filled with very nicely selected positions. So after these studies, there is also something which you have put in which I don't see in many books.
So then we come to a part when I wrote this book in 2015, I was not sure of this part, so I just gave it as a game. In year 2008, I had written one more book which was basically called Mastermind Chess, and most of the part, the 1, 2, 3 and 4, not 1 but 2 to 5, they have been taken up from the Mastermind. So it's top Mastermind and integrated this and added more positions into it. Now in Mastermind, it contained 300 games, and the idea was just to see that, okay, a chess player should know as much classics as possible. But when I started rewriting this book this year, then I came that, okay, you know, maybe we should go something more deeper. And then came the idea that most of the chess players, you must have also used, like they use memory to enhance the playing strength. And of course, we had all read that, like Kasparov knows some 3,000 positions at any given point of time, or Anand had memorized the entire B and C volume by the time he was 15. So like that's a very famous interview which had appeared on Chessbase with Jaideep Pundati, and he had asked him a question that whether you are really able to memorize it, and he said yes, I was able to. Like, you ask him with this variation, it appears on which page, you would be able to tell it on which page. So this is something where, you know, I have selected my personal 100 games, that is memorizing chess classics, and you have to memorize the game in entirety, not for one day or for a moment now, but this should become a part of yourself so long as you are playing chess, and that you should be able to recollect the game at any point of time. So like I have given the training method here, that the trainer explains the game to you in detail, opening nuances, subtle maneuvering, deep combination, and game skill. In each of these games, the masters have created a gem which makes us admire their prowess. And then once you have understood the game, make a point to play through the entire game on a chessboard by looking at the notation. The third step in this direction is to set up the pieces again and play through the game without looking at the notation. Of this learning pattern will make you remember the game. So like they should be able to remember the game. And I have done it in this way that these are the targets set for this 100 game, that 15 miniature game. So like you can find out 15 miniature game from this position and should do it in 1 month time. And then 15 miniatures learned earlier plus another 10 games we add, and this should be memorized. This 25 games should be the next step. So now you have memorized 25, then you go on further. So 25 games as at serial 2 above plus 15 more games at the end of 6 months, so as to memorize a total of 40 games. And now once you have done 40 games as at serial 3 above plus 20 more games at the end of 6 months, so as to memorize and recall 60 games. And then finally you have another 40, so that is how you reach 100. Of course, these are my personal beta. Player can have his own choice,
right?
Like some might like a Fischer's game, or some might go with Anand's game, or
Kasparov's
game.
So which is the first one?
Yeah, the first one, of course, here something I've done is I have put it in the order in which the player has won the world championship. Okay. So you'll always find Stenitz game at 1 and Lascar's game at 2 and Capablanca at 3.
Okay.
So like,
but there are these diagrams next to the game. So you have the entire game here on the left.
Yeah, the entire game is on the left. And like basically, Sagar, I've used your idea. I used to read your blog and I found that one word very interesting, memory marker. So at certain point of time, I have given the diagram and the moves played thereon. Mm-hmm. So now like it will be easy for a player that he goes through the game and these are the marker which will be etched in his mind forever. So this is the very famous famous Stenitz game which won him the Brilliancy Prize at Hastings in 1895. And then we come to the famous, the first example of double bishop sacrifice of Lascar. So this is how it goes. So like when the sacrifice comes on h7 and then again on g7. So these are the markers which a player will be able to understand.
So if they just put this in their mind, really use it in their game.
Yes. And I feel, you know, like there's one very famous, incident which I remember very, it's very fresh to my mind. International Master Atonu Lahiri was my colleague at LIC and he had come to play at a tournament in Mumbai. There was one very strong rating tournament and in fact he had won that tournament. And immediately after on then he had gone on to win the Commonwealth. So there, you know, like the same double bishop sacrifice, he played it on the board.
Wow.
So I think this helps a student. And then you go further. Of course, the order is not important. It is how you can start with miniature games and go in any order. But the idea is to remember the game.
Great. So people can learn the classics. So in a way, if you look at it, you have learned first from the first book the rules, then you learned about the mating patterns, then you learned about basic tactics, then you learned about the end games, then advanced tactics, and finally the compositions and classics. In a way, what is the level that it begins from, and until what level people can benefit from these books?
I think it starts at fundamentals. Means even children who has just taken to chess, or a parent who has just introduced his child to a chess, they can start with the chess course, the very basic book, the primer where all things are explained, and then you start solving the corresponding chapter in the workbook 1, and then go on and completing the stage. So like, and you graduate slowly, and the level of difficulty increases as you move on from book 1 to book 2. And in book 2, like you said, we have a lot of checkmating position, mate in 1, 640 to be precise. Like when you solve a lot of this position, automatically your strength will increase very quickly.
So you can say around from knowing nothing about chess, someone can reach at least 2000 or something.
I feel that like if he finishes book 6, book 6 I feel, and basically the part, the memorizing classics, should be, I think, nothing less than an international master.
Fantastic. And could you tell us this book, you know, when I was young, I read it. I learned a lot of things like the pin, the fork and everything from the chess course. So, but I never knew that the author was you. Now, of course, everyone knows you. So how many copies of this book have been sold until now?
I feel nothing less than a lakh. Has been sold over these 20 years.
So you mean to say 100,000
copies? 100,000 copies, yes. I think on an average, we have been able to sell 4,000 to 5,000 prints I had taken out. Of course, initially it was very slow, but especially during last 12 years, I think we have been printing nothing less than 6,000 to 7,000 copies in a year. And it's being used by a lot of trainers across India, a lot of academies. So I think that is, what we say, makes me feel proud. Okay, this is being used and beneficial to the chess fraternity.
Perhaps one of the highest selling books in the chess world, yes?
No, I don't think you. No, I think cannot be compared to the great masters who have churned out masterpieces.
Sure.
But I still feel, okay, it's very satisfying.
This is your biggest contribution to the chess world in a way.
Thank you. I feel it's a very small contribution. But whatever way means it helps more people at the grassroots level in taking up chess and, making chess something out of chess in future.
Thank you so much for your time and explaining these wonderful books.